I am Dr. Vinod Kumar P, Assistant Professor of Mathematics, TM Government College, Tirur. Dhanush program is a Kerala government initiative to help undergraduate students to get admissions for higher studies in premier institutions across India. Due to COVID pandemic situations, we are providing several online classes and problem solving sessions to help the students. As a part of this, today we will discuss about the topology of real numbers.
As you know, topology is a branch of pure mathematics that helps us to define convergence and continuity in more general spaces where there is no obvious distance concept. The word topology is also used to describe a mathematical concept that tells how elements of a set relate spatially to each other. So, at the same time, topology refers to a branch of mathematics and a mathematical concept. A topology on a set is a family of subsets containing the whole set and empty set, whose members are called open sets, which is closed under finite intersections and arbitrary unions. So, topology on a set is a collection of subsets which are called as open sets in such a way that the whole set, the empty set are open and arbitrary union of open sets are open and finite intersections of open sets are also open. In topology, open sets are everything. We are studying about properties which are formulated entirely in terms of open sets. If you are given with a space X, that means a set with a specific topology, then we can ask questions like, is X connected? Is it compact? Is it a metric space? What do continuous functions on X look like? Which sequences in X are convergent? And so on. In this lecture, we will discuss topological properties of the set of real numbers. You know that the set of real numbers has a rich mathematical structure. Algebraically, it is a field. In particular, it is a complete ordered field. It is a metric space. It is a norm space, an inner product space, and so on. Let us explore the topological structure of the set of real numbers. Recall that the distance between two real numbers x and y is given by modulus of x minus y. Many of the central ideas in analysis are dependent on the notion of two points being close to each other. If you are given some positive measure of closeness, say epsilon, we may be interested in all points y that are less than epsilon away from x. That is, we are looking at the set of all y such that mod x minus y less than epsilon. We formalize this idea in the following definition. Let x be a real number and epsilon greater than 0. A neighborhood of x is a set of the form all y in R such that mod x minus y less than epsilon. We will denote it as nx epsilon. Here the number epsilon is called the radius of the neighborhood nx epsilon. Okay, let us give a geometrical view of this. So consider the real line. The point x is here. So the interval x minus epsilon, x plus epsilon gives you the neighborhood nx epsilon. The set of all y in R such that mod x minus y less than epsilon is nothing but the open interval x minus epsilon, x plus epsilon, which is centered at the point x having radius epsilon. Sometimes we want to consider points y that are close to x but different from x. We can accomplish this by requiring that mod x minus y greater than 0. So this leads to the following definition. Let x be a real number and let epsilon greater than 0. A deleted neighborhood of x is a set of the form n star x epsilon, which is given by the set of all y in R such that 0 less than mod x minus y less than epsilon. So clearly we can observe that n star x epsilon is nothing but n x epsilon minus singleton set x. That is, the deleted neighborhood of x of radius epsilon is nothing but n x epsilon with the center x is removed. Geometrically, we have this picture. N star x epsilon consists of two open intervals, x minus epsilon x and the open interval x x plus epsilon. If S is a subset of the real line, then a point x in R can be thought of as being inside S or on the edge of S or outside of S. Saying that x is outside S is the same as saying that x is inside the complement of S, that is, inside the set R minus S. Using the concept of neighborhoods, we can make these intuitive ideas of inside, outside and edge more precise. Let S be a subset of R. A point x in R is an interior point of S if there exists a neighborhood n of x such that n is contained in S. So a point x is said to be an interior point of S if there is some neighborhood n of x which is lying inside S. We will call x as an exterior point of S if there is a neighborhood n of x which is lying outside S. That is, we are having a neighborhood n of x such that n is contained in the complement of S. If for every neighborhood n of x, n intersection S is non-empty as well as n intersection R minus S is also non-empty. That means every neighborhood of that point x intersects both S as well as its complement. In that situation, we will call that point x as a boundary point of S. So x is a boundary point of S if every neighborhood of that point intersects with S and R minus S. So a point is an interior point of a set S if there is a neighborhood which is contained in S. It is an exterior point if there is a neighborhood which completely lies outside of S, that means contained in the complement of S. A point is a boundary point means that every neighborhood of it contains both points in S and points outside S. Now, the set of all interior points of a set S is called the interior of S and it is denoted by int S. And the set of all boundary points of S is called the boundary of S, which is denoted by BDS or DOS. Remember that every point of S is either an interior point of S or a boundary point of S. Let us look at an example. Let S be the half open interval 0, 5. Here, the point 3 is an interior point of S because you can have a neighborhood of 3 that is contained in S. The same is true for any point x such that 0 less than x less than 5. So, we can conclude that all points x such that 0 less than x less than 5 is an interior point of this set. Therefore, interior of S is nothing but open interval 0, 5. Now look at the case of the point zero. Every neighborhood of zero, no matter how small it is containing points in S as well as points not in S. So zero is a boundary point. Similarly, if you look at 5, any neighborhood of 5 contains both points in S and points not in S. Therefore, 0 and 5 are boundary points, and therefore the boundary of this set is nothing but the set 0, 5. Now, isolated points. A point X is called an isolated point of a subset S of R if X is an element of S, but there exists a neighborhood of X which does not contain any other points of S. So a point X is an isolated point of a set S if X has a neighborhood which contains no other points of S. Suppose that every point of a set is an isolated point. That means your set is made up only of isolated points. In that case, the set is called a discrete set. For example, you can look at the set of natural numbers. Whatever natural number you take, you can see that for any n, natural number n, the neighborhood n minus half, the open interval n minus half, n plus half contains no other natural number. So, you can see that every point of the set of natural numbers is an isolated point. So, the set of natural numbers is a discrete set. It can be proved that any discrete subset S of R must be a countable set. But look at the case of rational numbers Q. The set of rational numbers Q is not discrete. Why? Because if you take any neighborhood of any rational number, then you know that between any two real numbers there are infinitely many rational numbers. So, whatever smaller neighborhood of a rational number you take, definitely that neighborhood will contain more and more rational numbers as well as irrational numbers. So, you can see that the set of rational numbers is not a discrete set and no point of Q is an isolated point. In fact, every point of Q is a boundary point of Q. Because whatever rational number you take, any neighborhood of that rational number contains both rationals as well as irrationals. That means every neighborhood of a rational number is intersecting Q as well as R minus Q. Therefore, every rational number is a boundary point of the set Q. Now let us define what we mean by open sets. A set U of real numbers is said to be open if for all x in U there exists delta greater than 0 such that the interval x minus delta x plus delta is contained in U. So a set of real numbers is said to be open if for every point in U there exists a delta neighborhood. Open interval x minus delta x plus delta which is lying inside U. In other words, it means that every point x in U must be an interior point of U. So for a set U to be open, we need that every point of U is an interior point of U. It is trivial that the set of real numbers R is open because whatever real number x you take, any interval x minus epsilon x plus epsilon is again a subset of R. Therefore, the set of real numbers is open. As empty set contains no points, it is vacuously true that empty set is open. So, both R and empty set are open subsets of R. Look at the intervals, open interval AB, open ray A infinity, open ray minus infinity A, all these are open sets. Not that, for establishing that a point x is an interior point of any of these sets, you have to choose a delta neighborhood, but the choice of delta depends upon the value of x in showing that these sets are open. Okay. Now let us define closed sets. A set A is said to be closed if its complement is open. So it is clear that the set of real numbers and empty set are both closed. Now look at the intervals closed ray minus infinity A, closed interval AB, closed ray B infinity. All these are closed sets because their complements are open sets in R. Remember that a set is not like a door. A door will always be either in one position, either it is open or closed. But a set may be open and closed. Sometimes it is neither open nor closed. Maybe open only, maybe closed only. All the possibilities are allowed. So remember that a set is not like a door. Open sets and closed sets. We make use of the idea of boundary to define open sets and closed sets in R in another way. You can observe that if you take any subset of R, then it may contain all of its boundary, part of its boundary, or none of its boundary. For example, if you consider closed interval AB, you know the boundary is nothing but set AB, which is contained in that set. So closed interval AB contains all of its boundary. Now if you consider half open interval, then it contains only a part of its boundary. But if you consider an open interval, then it contains none of the boundary points. Now here, the sets which contains all of its boundary points and the sets which does not contain any of its boundary points are of particular interest. We will make use of this idea to define open sets and closed sets. A set S of real numbers is said to be closed if it contains its boundary. That is, if boundary of S is subset of S, then S is said to be closed. If boundary of S is contained in the complement of S, that is boundary of S is subset of R minus S, in that case we say S is open. So we say that S is closed if it contains its boundary. That means it contains it all of its boundary points. If a set contains none of its boundary points, that means boundary is completely contained in R minus S, in that case we will say S is open. Now we can show that this definition of open sets and closed sets are similar with the previous definitions that we have given. We can prove that characterization as a theorem. A set is open if and only if S equal to interior of S. Equivalently, S is open if and only if every point in S is an interior point of S. Also, a set S is closed if and only if its complement R minus S is open. It is very easy to prove this theorem. Anyway, just look at it. If none of the points in S are boundary points of S, then all the points in S must be interior points of S. We know that any point of a set is either a interior point or a boundary point. So if none of the points are boundary points, then it is clear that all points in S are interior points, That means S is equal to interior of S. So one direction is clear. The converse also can be proved in the same way. For B part, we know that from the definition of boundary of S is the same as the boundary of its complement. So all the boundary is in S if and only if none of the boundary is in R minus S. So we can conclude that S is closed if and only if its complement is open. How do intersections and unions relate to open sets and closed sets? We have a theorem. The union of any collection of open sets is an open set. Also, the intersection of any finite collection of open sets is an open set. Let us try to prove it. Suppose A be an arbitrary collection of open sets and S is the union of all A in this collection, all sets A in this collection. Here is a small typing mistake. This stands for the union symbol. Sorry for that mistake. S is the union of all A such that A belongs to the collection of open sets that we have taken. If X is a point in S, then X belongs to the union so that it will belong to some A in A. As A is an open set, X will be an interior point of A. So you are having a neighborhood N of that point which is contained in A, and in particular it is contained in S. So that will imply that X is an interior point of S. So that shows that S is open. So we have noted that union of any collection of open sets is an open set. Now let us look at a finite collection of open sets, say A1, A2, extra AN, and T is defined as their intersection. Now if that intersection is empty, then there is nothing to prove because empty set is open. We want to show that finite intersection of open sets are open. So if that intersection happens to be empty, then there is nothing to prove. Suppose that intersection is non-empty, then it will contain some element. You take an X from T, then T is the intersection, therefore it means that X belongs to T means that X belongs to every AI. So as each AI is an open set, there will be neighborhoods ni x epsilon I of X such that ni x epsilon I is contained in AI. Now you take epsilon as the minimum of epsilon 1, epsilon 2, extra epsilon n. Then the set n x epsilon, the epsilon neighborhood, which is contained in all AI. So it means that it is contained in the intersection. That is, n x epsilon is contained in T. Thus, X is an interior point of T and T is therefore an open set. Thus, we have proved that the set of arbitrary union of open sets is open as well as finite intersections of open sets is open. Okay. Note that part B of this theorem does not necessarily hold for infinitely many open sets. That means an infinite intersection. That means intersection of infinitely many open sets need not be open. Let us give an example for that. For each n in n, consider the open interval minus 1 by n, 1 by n as your set An. Then as they are open intervals, they are open sets. Each An is an open set. But what about the intersection of all these An's? Intersection n equal to 1 to infinity An. You can observe that as 1 by n tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, you can see that intersection n equal to 1 to infinity An is nothing but singleton set 0. which is of course not open because 0 is not an interior point of that set. So we are observing that open sets have shrunk down through intersection to a set that is not open. Our next corollary follows easily from the previous theorem and from the fact that a set is open if and only if its complement is closed. Intersection of any collection of closed sets is closed. So arbitrary intersection of closed sets is closed. And union of any finite collection of closed sets is closed. It is very easy to prove this fact, this corollary, using De Morgan's law. And from the previous theorem, and also from the fact that a set is open if and only if its complement is closed. Here also, the union of any finite collection of closed sets is closed. But if you take an infinite collection of closed sets and their union, then it need not be closed. For example, you consider the closed sets An given by closed interval 1 by N2 for each N element of N. Then, what is the union of N equal to 1 to infinity An? It is nothing but half open interval 0 to. You know, this set is not closed because 2 is not an interior point of this set. So we have seen that closed sets have built up by taking unions to a set that is not closed. Now let us see what we mean by accumulation points or limit points. By using the idea of deleted neighborhoods, we can define another important property of points and sets. Suppose S is a subset of R, and a point x in R is said to be an accumulation point of S if every deleted neighborhood of X contains a point of S. That is, for every epsilon greater than 0, the deleted neighborhood n star x epsilon intersection with S is non-empty. So it means that a point x in R is an accumulation point of S if every neighborhood of X contains some point of S other than X. Okay. So, a point X in R is an accumulation point of S if every deleted neighborhood of X contains a point of S. In other words, every neighborhood of S contains some point of S other than X is. In that case, X is known as an accumulation point or sometimes called as a limit point of S. Now, the set of all accumulation points of S is known as the derived set of S and it is denoted by S prime. Suppose X is an element of S and X is not an element of S prime. That means X is not an accumulation point. In that case, X will be an isolated point of S. Because if X is not in S prime, that means X is not an accumulation point. So, you will be having a neighborhood of X which contains only that point of S. So, it means that X is an isolated point of S. Let us look at an example. Suppose S is the interval, half open interval 0, 1. Then, S prime will be equal to closed interval 0, 1. It's very easy to observe it. Suppose S is a set of all 1 by N with n element of N. That means a set 1, 1 by 2, 1 by 3, 1 by 4 like that. Then what is the derived set S prime? The set of all accumulation points of this set. You can see that S prime is nothing but singleton set 0. Because even though 0 is not a point of this set, every neighborhood of 0 contains infinitely many 1 by n's. Because you know that the sequence 1 by n converges to 0. So if you take any neighborhood of it, it will certainly, that means we are looking at an epsilon interval about 0, minus epsilon epsilon. It will contain all 1 by n's after some stage. It means that every neighborhood of 0 contains points of S. That means 0 is a limit point or an accumulation point, but 0 is not a point of it. Now look at S equal to the set of natural numbers. Then you can see that every point in every natural number is an isolated point of the set N. So S prime will be empty. So N consists entirely of isolated points. No accumulation points are there. If S is a finite set, then of course you can see S prime will be equal to empty. Now let us define what we mean by the closure of a set. Closure of a set is denoted by CLS, defined as CLS is equal to S union S prime. That means the set along with its all accumulation points. So S together with all of its accumulation points is called the closure of S. Now you can observe that in terms of neighborhoods, a point X is in the closure of S if and only if every neighborhood of X intersects S. To say this, suppose X belongs to closure of S and let N be a neighborhood of S. If X is a point of S, then certainly N intersection S contains S, X. If X is not a point of S, then of course X will be an element of S prime. That means X is an accumulation point. Then by definition of accumulation points, every deleted neighborhood intersects S. Thus, in any case, the neighborhood N must contain points of S. So every neighborhood must intersect S. So we have proved that direction. If a point X is in the closure, then every neighborhood of X intersects S. Now for the converse, suppose that every neighborhood of X intersects S. If X is not a point of S, then every neighborhood of X intersects S in a point other than X. So that means that X belongs to S prime. That is, X is an accumulation point. So it means that X belongs to the closure of S, because closure of S is nothing but S union S prime. The basic relationship between accumulation points, closure and closed sets are presented in the following theorem. Let S be a subset of R, then S is closed if and only if S contains all of its accumulation points. Closure of S is a closed set. S is closed if and only if S is equal to closure of S, and closure of S is equal to S union boundary of S. It is an easy exercise to prove this theorem. I am leaving it to the students. Now, in the beginning, we have mentioned that in topology, open sets are important. And also in general topological spaces, there is no concept of distance. Now let us see how we define convergence using open sets. You know that in case of real sequences, a sequence xn is said to converge to the real number x, provided that for every epsilon greater than 0, there is a natural number n such that for all n element of n with n greater than or equal to n, we have mod xn minus x less than epsilon. That means for any epsilon greater than 0, there is a natural number n such that for every n greater than or equal to n, the terms xn satisfies the inequality mod xn minus x less than epsilon. We make use of this idea to define convergence in terms of open sets. Not that mod xn minus x is less than epsilon means that xn belongs to the interval x minus epsilon, x plus epsilon. So for the convergence, we need that whatever epsilon you take, the epsilon interval x minus epsilon, x plus epsilon contains all terms of the sequence after some stage. We define a sequence xn converging to a point x if for every open set U in R containing x there exists a positive integer n such that for every n greater than or equal to n xn belongs to U. So in this way we can define convergence of sequences using only open sets. So this definition can be extended to any topological space. See, in the first definition, that means our usual definition, with mod xn minus x less than epsilon, we need the idea of subtraction, we need the concept of distance, which is provided here by means of the absolute value, and this inequality. These type of things are not available in an arbitrary topological space. So this definition makes sense only when there is a notion of subtraction, a notion of this type of inequality, and the concept of distance all are present. So in an arbitrary topological space, we can extend the definition of convergence by using this idea. A sequence is converging to a point x if for every open set U containing that point, there is a natural number n such that after that n, all the terms of the sequence belongs to that open set. Okay. Now let us see how to define continuity using open sets. This is our definition of continuity in analysis. A function f from R to R is continuous if for each a in R and for each positive real number epsilon, there exists a positive real number delta such that mod x minus a less than delta implies mod f of x minus f of a less than epsilon. So it means that when x and a are very close, their images are also close. So continuity roughly means that the function takes nearby points to nearby points. We extend this definition without using any of these ideas like subtraction, modulus, distance, inequalities. Without these things, we will extend the definition of continuity using only the concept of open sets. A function f from R to R is continuous at a point x if for every open set V in R containing f of x, there exists an open set U in R such that f of U is contained in V. Also, a function f from R to R is continuous if for every open set V in R, f inverse V is open in R. Thus, we can extend the definition of continuity purely in terms of open sets. So that this it is very easy to prove that these two definitions are equivalent. And also this definition uses only the idea of open sets, so we can extend the idea of continuity to any arbitrary topological space with this way of definition. Now let us discuss another important topological aspect, namely compactness. Compactness is the next best thing than finiteness. A set S is said to be compact if whenever it is contained in the union of a family script F of open sets, then it is contained in the union of some finite number of the sets in script F. So if script F is a family of open sets whose union contains S, then script F is called an open cover of S. If G is a subset of F and if G is also an open cover of S, in that case G is called a subcover of S. We define a set S to be compact if every open cover of S contains a finite subcover. So a set S is said to be compact if every open cover of S contains a finite subcover. That means If you are having a collection of open sets whose union contains S, then it is always possible to identify finitely many of them such that this finite union contains S. Let us look at an example. The interval S is equal to open interval 0. You can observe that it is not compact. Why? Just consider the sets An consisting of open intervals 1 by n 3 for each n in n. So this is your S. So this is your A1, that means 1 by 1, that means 1. So A1 is open interval 1, 3. Now A2 is open interval 1 by 2, 3. A3 is open interval 1 by 3, 3. 1 by 3, 3. Like that. So if 0 less than x less than 2, then by the Archimedean property of real numbers, we know that there is a positive integer, there is a natural number p such that 1 by p less than x. So if x is any real number between 0 and 2, then there definitely exists a natural number p such that 1 by p less than x, so that x belongs to 1 by p open interval 1 by p 3, that is x belongs to ap. So you can see that this collection of all an's forms an open cover for S. But if you take any finite subcollection of it, say an1, an2, extra ank, and if you take m as the maximum of this n1, n2, extra ank, then you can see that an1 union an2 union extra union ank is nothing but am, that is the open interval 1 by m 3. So it follows that no finite subcollection is a open cover of open interval 0 2. So this open cover does not admit a finite subcover. So we can conclude that open interval 0 2 is not compact. Another example, consider a finite set and A alpha, collection A alpha be an open cover of S. So for each I equal to 1 to extra n, definitely there will be a set A alpha I from this collection that contains xi, since F is an open cover. So you can name it as A alpha 1, A alpha 2, A alpha 3, like that. So you are getting a subfamily A alpha 1 extra A alpha n that also covers us. So we conclude that any finite set is compact. In proving a set is compact, we must show that every open cover has a finite subcover. In order to show that a set is not compact, you need only to establish it has an open cover which doesn't have any finite subcover. But for proving a set to be compact, it is more difficult because you have to show that every open cover has a finite subcover. So it is not sufficient to pick a particular open cover and extract a finite subcover. Because of this fact, it is often difficult to show directly that a given set satisfies the definition of being compact. Fortunately, there is a classical Hilbert theorem which gives us a easier characterization to use for subsets of R, which is also applicable for Euclidean spaces Rn. Before stating the Hilbert theorem, let us have a lemma. If S is a non-empty closed bounded subset of R, then S has a maximum and a minimum. So if S is a non-empty closed bounded subset of R, then S has a maximum and a minimum. Suppose S is bounded above and non-empty. Since R is complete, the supremum will exist. Let small m be the supremum. We want to show that this m is an element of S. If m is an accumulation point of S, then since S is closed, we have m belongs to S, and m will be the maximum marks. So if m is not an accumulation point of s, then what happens? Then for some epsilon greater than 0, we will have that the Dillinger neighborhood n star m epsilon intersection s with is empty. But m is the least upper bound of s. So n m epsilon intersection s is non-empty. If this intersection were empty, then what happens? Then m minus epsilon will be an upper bound of s, which is a contradiction. M is the least upper bound. So this neighborhood n m epsilon intersection s is non-empty. So that shows that m must be an element of s. If m is not in s, we are getting a contradiction. If m is not an accumulation point of s, we are getting a contradiction. So this shows that m is an element of s. So again we have m is equal to maximum minus. In a similar way, you can show that infimum of s is again an element of s. So infimum of s is the minimum of s. So that proves the lemma. Now let us state the Hainborn theorem. A subset S of R is compact if and only if S is closed and bounded. So a subset S of the real line is compact if and only if the set S is closed and bounded. This is the classical Hainborn theorem. Let us try to prove it. First, suppose that S is compact. We want to show that S is closed and bounded. For each n element of n, consider in as the open interval minus nn. Then each in is an open set, and also S is contained in the union of all these ins. So that shows that the collection in n equal to 1, 2, 3 extra is an open cover of S. We assumed that S is compact, therefore there exist finitely many integers n1 extra nk such that S is contained in in1 union extra union ink. You can take m as the maximum of these indices n1 extra nk, then in1 union extra union ink is nothing but in. So you are getting that S is contained in in. So that shows that mod x is less than m for all x in s. That implies S is bounded. Next, we have to show that S is closed. For that, suppose S is not closed. We already assumed that S is compact. Again, suppose that S is not closed. Try to derive some contradiction. If S is not closed, then there would exist a point P belonging to closure of S minus S. Then, for each n in n, you consider the set un equal to the open ray minus infinity p minus 1 by n union p plus 1 by n infinity. Let us look at the set u1 minus infinity p minus 1 union p plus 1 infinity. So this is your u2, similarly u3, like that. So you can observe that each un is an open set, and what about the union of all these uns? As n tends to infinity, 1 by n tends to 0, so that p minus 1 by n and p plus 1 by n approaches to p as n tends to infinity, so that we get union n equal to 1 to infinity, un is nothing but r minus p. Only the point p is removed from r. So it contains your S. So it means that this collection is a UN, this collection UN with n equal to 1, 2, 3 extra is an open cover of S. But we assumed that S is compact. So there exists finitely many indices n1, n2. You can take like that n1 less than n2 less than extra less than nk such that S is contained in union I equal to 1 to k UNi. Furthermore, these UNs are nested. UM is contained in UN if m less than or equal to n. So it follows that S is contained in UNK. But then S intersection with n, p, 1 by n, nk is empty. So this contradicts our choice that P belongs to closure of S minus S, and showing that S must be closed. So one direction is over. We have proved that if S is compact, then S is both closed and bounded. Now let us try to prove the converse part. Suppose that S is closed and bounded, we want to show that S is compact. Suppose script F be an open cover of S. Then for each x element of R, you define the set Sx consisting of all cells in S such that set less than or equal to S. That means S is nothing but, Sx is nothing but Sx is equal to S intersection the closed ray minus infinity x. And let B is the set of all x such that Sx is covered by a finite subcover of script F. You can look at some example to get a clear idea. So here SW will be empty, S is this and this, union of these two closed intervals. W is this point. So if you look at SW, SW is nothing but S intersection minus infinity W. So it is non-empty. It is empty. SW is empty. Now if you take X here, then Sx will be this closed interval. If you take Y as the point, then what is Sy? Sy will be this set. Sy will be consisting of these two closed intervals. If your set is a point here, then what will be your S set? It will be your S set. So since S is closed and bounded, by the previous lemma we see that S has a minimum, say D. In this case the minimum of S is this point D. Then what is SD? SD is nothing but, SD is what? SD is the intersection of S with the closed ray minus infinity D. So SD will be singleton set D. So this is certainly covered by a finite subcover of it, because SD has only one element. Thus D is an element of B, and B is therefore a non-empty collection. So we have shown that this B, if you take as the collection of all X such that Sx is covered by a finite subcover of F, then this B is a non-empty collection. If we can show that B is not bounded above, then it will contain a number set greater than supremum of S. But then Sz will be equal to S. Since Z is an element of B, it will imply that S is compact, because S has a, S is covered by a finite subcover of F. So we have Sx is all set in S such that Z less than or equal to X, and B is a set of all X such that Sx is covered by a finite subcover of script. Suppose that B is bounded above, and let M be the supremum of B. We shall show that M is an element of S and M is not an element of S. Both lead to the contradictions. If M is an element of S, then script F is an open cover of S. So there exists F0 in script F such that M is an element of F0. So there will be some F0 which contains your M. Since F0 is open, there exists an interval, closed interval x1, x2 in F0 such that x1 less than M less than x2. Since x1 is less than M and M is a supremum of B, so there exists F1 extra Fk in script F that covers Sx1. So you are having f1 extra fk, which covers sx1. But then f0 f1 extra fk covers sx2, so that x2 belongs to B. So x2 is a member of B and m is less than x2. This contradicts the fact that m is the supremum of B. Now suppose that B is not bounded above and m is a supremum of B, and suppose that m is not an element of S. Since S is closed and m is not an element of S, there is a positive epsilon such that nm epsilon intersection S is empty. So your m is somewhere like this. You are having a neighborhood nm epsilon which doesn't intersect with S. Then sm minus epsilon equal to sm plus epsilon by 2. Since m minus epsilon is an element of B, we have m plus epsilon by 2 element of B, which again contradicts the fact that m is the supremum of B. Since the possibility that B is bounded above, in that case it will have a supremum, and then that supremum belongs to S and not belongs to S, all lead to a contradiction. We must conclude that B is not bounded above and hence S is compact. So this completes the proof of the Hain-Borel theorem. We studied that a finite set will have no accumulation points. We also noted that some unbounded sets such as N have no accumulation points. As an application of the Hain-Borel theorem, we now derive the classical Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem, which states that these are the only conditions that can allow a set to have no accumulation points. If a set is bounded and infinite, then it must have accumulation points. So that is the content of the classical Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. So the statement is, if a bounded subset S of R contains infinitely many points, then there exists at least one point in R that is an accumulation point of S. In order to prove this, let S be a bounded subset of R containing infinitely many points, and suppose that S has no accumulation points. Then clearly S will be closed. So by the Hain-Borel theorem, S will be compact. Since S has no accumulation points, given any x in S, there exists a neighborhood nx of x such that S intersection nx equal to singleton set x. So here it is like this. Nx is a neighborhood of x which contains no other points of x. So for each point you are having this. So for each point in S, you are having such open sets, such neighborhoods. Then the family of all such Nx is an open cover of S. As S is compact, there must exist a finite subcover. But each of these Nx1, Nx2 extra contains only one element. So S intersection Nx1 union extra union Nxn is nothing but set X1 extra Xn. That means S is nothing but singletons. S is nothing but the finite set X1 extra Xn. This contradicts the fact that S has infinitely many points. So this completes the proof of the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. So from the Hain-Borel theorem, we have concluded the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem, which says that a bounded subset of R containing infinitely many points always has at least one accumulation point. Now have another theorem. Consider a family of compact subsets of R, set K alpha with alpha belonging to some indexing set A. Say family of compact subsets. And suppose that the intersection of any finite subfamily of script f is non-empty. Then our claim is that intersection of all k alpha with alpha element of script A is also non-empty. So if any finite subfamily has a non-empty intersection, then the whole family also has a non-empty intersection, where k alphas are compact subsets of R. In order to prove this, for each alpha in A, let f alpha be the complement of k alpha. Since each k alpha is compact, it is closed, therefore its complement must be open. So every f alpha is an open set in R. Now choose a member k of script f and suppose that no point of k belongs to every k alpha. Then every point of k belongs to some f alpha. That is, the sets f alpha forms an open cover of k. But k is given to be compact. So there exist finitely many indices alpha 1 extra alpha n such that k is contained in f alpha 1 union extra union f alpha n. But f alpha 1 union extra union f alpha n is nothing but r minus k alpha 1 union extra union r minus k alpha n. So that is nothing but r minus k alpha 1 intersection extra intersection k alpha n using the De Morgan's laws. So this shows that k intersection with the k alpha 1 extra k alpha n is empty, because k is contained in this union and this union is nothing but the complement of this set. So k intersection with this intersection, so it's again a finite intersection, which is again a finite intersection of members of this family. So which is, this intersection is empty is a contradiction, because our assumption is that intersection of any finite subfamily of script f is non-empty. So this contradiction shows that some point in k belongs to every k alpha. That means intersection k alpha is non-empty. Okay. Now let us have a corollary, the nested interval theorem. So suppose that you are having a family of closed and bounded intervals in R, An, such that An plus 1 is contained in An for every N, then intersection of all An is non-empty. This is the nested interval theorem. So A1 is like this, A2 is a smaller one. So you are having that A2 is contained in A1, A3 is contained in A2, like that. Generally An plus 1 is contained in An. Our claim is that this intersection of all these An's is non-empty. So for any given n1 less than n2 less than extra less than nk in n, we have the intersection of I equal to 1 to k an I will be ank, which is a closed interval, therefore it is non-empty. So we are having the finite intersection property. Any finite intersection is non-empty. Therefore by previous theorem we get that the intersection of all the ans is also non-empty. So this proves the nested intervals theorem. Okay. So a very easy deduction from the previous theorem. So we have seen compactness means a subset of R is compact if it is closed and bounded from the Hain-Borel theorem. So compactness means that every open cover has a finite subcover. So in some sense, compact means small. But it is a peculiar kind of smallness. But at its heart, compactness is a precise way of being small in the mathematical world. See, the smallness is peculiar. Why it is peculiar? Because in the example of an open interval 0, 1, open interval 0, 1, you know that this set is not compact because it has open covers which doesn't admit finite subcover. Or another way, from Hain-Borel theorem, it is not closed, therefore it cannot be compact. But if you adjoin the endpoint 0, n, 1 to this set, then it will be compact. And compact means it is small. So by adding more points, our set becomes smaller. This set is not compact. Open interval 0,1 is not compact. But by adding two more points to it, making it small. That is the peculiarity. Now consider this case, closed interval 0,1. This set is a compact set, being a closed and bounded set. Now, this set is compact, therefore it is a, some sense it is finite. But if you remove the points, closed interval 0,1 is compact, therefore it is small in some sense. But if you remove the points, the endpoints 0 and 1, what happens? It will become open interval. It's not compact. So which is not small in our sense, which is large, a larger set. So if you remove some points from the set, it becomes, if you remove some points from this set, it becomes large. And if you add some points to this set, it will become small. That is why I have mentioned that compactness is a peculiar kind of smallness. But this property is a very important property and has many far-reaching consequences in many theorems. An interesting article about compactness is given in this link. You can have a read on that. You can read it. It is the blog of Scientific American. What does compactness really mean? With this, we finish our lecture. Thank you all. Thank you.